Self-driving vehicles have the potential to change the auto industry forever. Fully autonomous vehicles, or AV for short, will, one day, we're told, be able to operate without a human in the car, and this could completely change the concept of vehicle ownership. For those with autonomous capable cars, their self-driving vehicles could actually earn them money, something Tesla CEO Elon Musk has talked about with Tesla's future promised fleet of Tesla taxis. Not driving your Tesla? Well, then let it go out and earn you money by ferrying your neighbours around instead. Another possible direction that the auto industry could go once AV technology becomes available worldwide would be to eliminate the private ownership vehicle experience completely. Theoretically, the value of autonomous vehicles would be much higher than their non-autonomous counterparts due to the aforementioned earning potential that an AV can offer whoever physically owns it. This could cause vehicle prices to absolutely skyrocket, putting private ownership out of the question for all but the most wealthiest of consumers. Additionally, riding in autonomous vehicles would be substantially cheaper than traditional ride-sharing platforms. You wouldn't have to pay a driver, after all, which would then further increase the price disparity between private ownership and using a public ride-sharing platform instead. The third reason why private ownership could actually disappear? Well, car companies could stop selling them to private individuals. Just think about it. If all vehicles suddenly have an earning potential, then why on earth would auto manufacturers continue to make and sell affordable cars to the public when they could instead own the cars themselves and take in all of the profits generated from their company-owned autonomous fleet operations? Or maybe they could just sell them to big corporations who would have a predictable turnaround of vehicles over time. Whichever direction the auto industry moves in, there is still one underlying question that everyone wants answered. When is this all going to happen? The answer to this question is pretty complicated and is also pretty nuanced. And because of this, we thought that today the most palatable way to approach this question would be instead to ask what would need to happen before we say goodbye to the steering wheel and the pedals. After all, if autonomous vehicles will eventually eliminate human drivers, at least so we're told, and if autonomous vehicles will eliminate car ownership, then the first step to all of this thing is getting rid of the things we use to control our cars today. Steering wheels and pedals. In order for that to happen, of course, we need cars to achieve level 5 autonomous operation, where no human interaction is needed at all. So today, we're going to focus on what needs to happen technologically to reach that level 5 autonomy, which of course means outlining some of the challenges that exist to getting there. We'll then think about which vehicles might be the first to lose their steering wheels and pedals, and ask which vehicles might be the last. Finally, we're going to consider if our vision of what a fully autonomous future will look like may or may not actually line up with the trajectory that this technological development will end up taking. One thing that we are not going to do, though, is to make date and time predictions for when this is all going to happen. Estimates for when level 5 autonomy become available, they vary widely from several months to many years, and so it would make absolutely zero sense to try and speculate on this one. But when we've got more solid data, a prediction might be possible. But right now, sorry. So the race for level 5 autonomy and level 4 autonomy before that. I can't make a video about autonomous vehicles without talking about Alphabet, formerly Google, and its decade or more of work into autonomous vehicles. Its offshoot Waymo has been operating level 4 taxis for quite some time, sometimes without anyone in the driver's seat, although I understand that those vehicles are still monitored and capable of being controlled remotely. Then of course we have Tesla, which also previewed its own full self-driving features in several company videos. And no, I'm not talking about autopilot level 2 or level 3 functionality that many Tesla owners enjoy on a daily basis. I'm talking about what looks to be a high level 3 or maybe even a low level 4 autonomous operation. Just last week, Elon Musk sent out a series of tweets giving an update on Tesla's progress with full self-driving. He said that he's been driving a development version of the software that's capable of running between his home and the office with, quote, almost zero interventions. Elon then went on to say that there could be a limited public release of the software in 6 to 10 weeks. If this is true, it would be a huge step forwards towards the goal of level 5 autonomy. Release of this alpha or beta software would probably place Tesla somewhere between level 3 and level 4. And hopefully we will know more soon. Tesla and Waymo's approaches to autonomous vehicle operation are pretty different. Tesla uses a combination of radar and vision sensors to detect the world around the vehicle, while Waymo relies heavily on LiDAR. In a vision-focused system, the vehicle takes images from several cameras around the vehicle and then uses machine learning to detect the obstacles and conditions seen in those images. LiDAR-based systems, meanwhile, detect the 3D landscape around the car and rely on rapidly generated 3D maps to pick out obstacles. There are several pros and cons with each system, but again, that's for another video. As of now, Waymo has begun offering driverless taxi services in some US cities with heavily geofenced environments. So far, those services are really limited to just a few neighborhoods. It's assumed, though, that when Tesla will launch, it won't geofence its full self-driving feature. But that really does depend on legislation. Waymo's operations are currently being allowed through special exemptions at both federal and local levels, and Tesla would presumably need something similar to operate its vehicles fully autonomously, as would any other company seeking to do the same out there. The main commonality between the two approaches is that the systems, which rely heavily on machine learning, improve over time as they acquire more data. In this way, computers are a lot like people. The more practice a computer gets, the better it becomes at completing a certain task. Because of this fact, all of the companies currently competing for the self-driving crown are really in a data race. Some of this data can be gathered through computer simulations, but road testing is also extremely valuable. Waymo is gathering data through its aforementioned taxi service, which is called Waymo One, while Tesla is able to improve its algorithms by gathering live data from the vehicles that it already has out on the road. Mainly, your cars. Data is perhaps the biggest technological barrier between Level 4 and Level 5 autonomy. In order to reach Level 5, companies need to patiently continue to gather more data until their algorithms are safe enough to be let out on the road. Unfortunately, data is not the only thing, though, standing between us and a fully autonomous future. And there are several other problems preventing the imminent release of AV technology. The first, of course, is legislation. Because autonomous vehicles are completely new, there's very little understanding and very few laws on the books that permit and regulate their development and adoption. Some states, like Nevada, for example, have been super progressive with their autonomous vehicle legislation, enacting laws which help guide the development and eventual deployment of AVs. But around the world, there are still many governments and jurisdictions who've done nothing. In my opinion, there needs to be a global collaboration on drafting autonomous vehicle legislation so that when the technology is capable, it can be deployed smoothly without hiccups and market restrictions. If different markets have different standards and requirements for autonomous vehicles, it will slow up the deployment of autonomous vehicles and drive up costs for manufacturers. But even if there was a global effort to synchronize autonomous vehicle legislation, we can only limit unnecessary market differentiation. Automakers will still have to deal with the inherent differences in how people drive around the world. And no, I'm not talking about the difference between driving on the right or the left. Street signs, road markings, traffic laws, and driving conditions all change depending on where you are in the world. In addition to all of this, there are also major cultural differences in each region that governs how drivers and pedestrians and other road users act, which leads to wildly different driving styles. Because of this, it's possible that autonomous vehicles will need to undergo the same arduous data collection process in each global market, which will slow things down a lot. The final hurdle still standing in the way of legal 5 developments are edge cases. Some of you may have heard this term before, but put simply, edge cases refer to scenarios which require a driver to problem solve and go beyond normal driving habits. For example, imagine that you're driving down a 2-lane road and there is a dead deer in your lane. A normal driver would check to make sure it's safe and then pull over into the oncoming lane to avoid the deer. In this scenario, the driver made the decision to do something that would normally be considered unsafe. In fact, maybe even breaking the law, pulling into an oncoming lane to avoid an obstacle. That scenario may seem very rare, but edge cases are quite common and they happen all around us. We're talking about things like construction zones, disappearing lane lines, strange traffic lights, potholes, speed bumps, detours, emergency vehicles, and then weather conditions. These are just some of the many, many edge cases that Level 5 autonomous vehicles will need to take in their stride. In most of these scenarios, humans need to quickly troubleshoot the situation and then hopefully adjust their driving characteristics to stay safe. It's much more difficult for autonomous vehicles to do the same. It is for this reason that geofenced level 4 autonomy is much easier than level 5. If you can geofence out all of the more difficult edge cases, then frankly, autonomous driving becomes a whole lot easier. With all of these different obstacles still standing in the way of autonomous vehicles, then what will an AV rollout look like? For services like Waymo, I could see a slow expansion of geofenced fleets of level 4 taxis to new markets around the US. Most likely in predictable urban and suburban areas. As for Tesla, full self-driving will most likely take a market-to-market approach. As it slowly becomes legal in different jurisdictions, Tesla may begin to slowly roll out the feature. Because the algorithms may need to be trained in different markets separately, Tesla may actually be forced to activate full self-driving across different countries in a staged way. This, though, is all speculation, but it could mean that full self-driving will become available in some countries months or even years before others. Even when level 5 autonomy does become possible, though, don't expect consumer vehicles to lose their steering wheels right away. Depending on governmental regulations and consumer pressures, automakers may just decide to hang on to their steering wheels for a while. Some buyers may still have use cases which are incompatible with fully autonomous driving. For anyone who wants to go camping or off-roading, hanging onto a steering wheel is probably going to continue to be a thing. But here's where it gets frustrating. There's a difference between a feature that's flawless and a feature that's almost there. And while level 5 autonomy requires by its very definition the ability to operate everywhere, it's going to be really hard to achieve that. It may end up like those early voice assistants, okay in some situations, but terrible in others. Or autocorrect. If we're looking for full autonomy, we cannot have the mistakes and bug versus feature problems that come along with other forms of technology that we use daily and laugh about when the computer gets it wrong. They will need to be like airplane autopilot systems, rugged, reliable, and even when they go wrong, capable of ceding control to a human in a safe fashion. There are moments when, like voice assistants and autocorrect, doing it yourself may be quicker. When people talk about self-driving cars, they usually make the argument that point-to-point driving will become effortless and so no one is ever going to need to touch a steering wheel again. But I still think there are moments when being able to drive yourself will be far easier and better to do. For example, let's say that you just want to pull your car out 2 feet of the garage so that you can access something in the boot. Or maybe you need to hook your vehicle up to a trailer. Or you need to back that trailer down a boat ramp to unload your boat. All of these things could be done autonomously, but trying to get your vehicle to understand that that is the thing you want it to do would probably just take up more time than just doing it yourself. Voice assistants have been around for years, and yet most people still do not bother with them half of the time because operating them is more frustrating and time-consuming than just doing the task yourself. For this reason, I think that having a steering wheel is going to transition away from being a safety feature towards being a comfort and convenience feature. I personally really hope that I never find myself sat in a steering wheelless car, pleading with it to pull 2 inches further to one side so I can fit something else in the garage beside it. The meme potential for this comedic vision is both similarly terrifying and eternally amusing. And if you don't know what I mean, look up the comedy sketch done on the BBC a number of years ago about the voice-controlled elevator and the Scottish accent. I'll link to it. In terms of a timeline, I expect fleet vehicles to have their steering wheels removed first. Cars which are never expected to encounter edge cases will probably follow. Privately owned vehicles will probably get self-driving tech at a similar time, but they will probably hang on to their steering wheels and pedals for the previously mentioned reasons. Even as this transition is going on, though, it seems that there will be some vehicles which will never get fully autonomous technology. Construction vehicles and other vehicles which are needed on job sites could be examples of vehicles where removing the steering wheel would be a hindrance and potentially dangerous. Similarly, fire trucks, police cars, and other emergency vehicles may not yet be benefited by self-driving tech. All of these vehicles will probably need to hang onto their steering wheels for the foreseeable future. Essentially, I think the general rule of thumb is that any vehicle which either is not solely used for point-to-point transportation or is sometimes required to drive in ways which ignore the rules of the road will take a lot longer to be automated than other vehicles. Some people envision an autonomous future where car ownership becomes a thing of the past. And I do think there is some truth to that, at least for those who live in large, busy, urban centres. But then there are plenty of us who don't live in major cities, areas where Google Street Map cars haven't been, or where there are still dirt track roads rather than actual tarmacked roads. In those situations, it's going to take a very long time before steering wheels and pedals disappear completely. Getting autonomous rideshare vehicles out to the boonies will not happen anytime soon. And as someone who lives in the boonies, I frankly do not want to ride in one anytime soon. There's just too much out here that can jump out of the hedge, from errant chickens and young deer to fully grown black bears, and of course, in other parts of the world, even larger, heavier, more menacing creatures. That means for now that people will likely hold on to non-autonomous vehicles, and I haven't even touched on those classic fleets and those retro vehicles that will still be sharing the world. If I lived in a busy urban centre, maybe I could, in the future, go completely car-free, just renting a non-autonomous vehicle when I needed to go somewhere where non-autonomous vehicles needed to go, using autonomous vehicles for daily trips around town. In a post-COVID world, it might certainly feel safer too from a health point of view. And even before COVID, I mean, riding alone at night on public transport has never been pleasant, especially if you're a woman. But where I live right now, I'm not 100% convinced it will ever happen before I'm ready to hang up my driving shoes. What do you think still needs to happen before we get rid of those manual controls? Let us know in the comments below. That's it. Thanks for joining me, and I'll see you next time.